hematuria in the past, any history of hematuria, sir. And where is the pain localized, sir? Actually, since he's complaining of abdominal pain, I would just like
left flank pain.
Left flank pain, sir. Okay.
Yeah. Just the left flank pain and discomfort. It's more of a discomfort, not requiring any analgesic. So you can understand it's just a mild pain.
Okay. So since this is a mild pain with no history of any leuturia, hematuria, and no history of any fever or history of any urinary tract infections, I would like to ask, sir.
Okay, history of UTI. Okay.
Yes, sir.
What else you want to ask?
And whether he has taken any treatment in the past, sir?
No treatment. Okay. Yeah. This is the first time consultation. No investigation, no treatment in the past. So, Vijay, what comes in your mind when you are taking the history like this? Pain, vague pain, or left side flank pain, vague. What comes in your mind?
Sir, first, I want to know what is the exact location of the pain. Is it vague or is it sharp? What is the nature of or characteristic of the pain? Whether it is intermittent colicky pain or present all the day, all the duration?
No, whatever is written is the one which is the characteristic of pain. It's located in the left flank and vague, dull, aching pain. He is not able to tell anything more than what is written here.
Okay. So the pain left flank, sir, differential which will come into my mind, which I will think about, is a stone disease, sir, a renal stone disease, PUJ obstruction. And if any past history of fever, UTIs, then I will keep pyelonephritis also in the differential. VUR I will keep in the differential. I will ask if any antenatal scan or any history of previous from the mother, I would like to inquire if.
Why you want to keep VUR as a differential diagnosis?
VUR could be, sir, persistent VUR could be, rarely can be present, sir, in a patient if there is any anatomical defect.
Can it present in the adulthood, VUR?
It can, sir, if it is uncomplicated and yes.
Okay, Pramod, you agree with him that one of the causes of presentation of a VUR is a left flank pain at the age of 26 years?
No, sir, I disagree, sir. Either if it is presenting with a VUR, then either it could be a duplex system where one moiety is refluxing, one moiety is obstructing. That can cause a pain. But a primary VUR, very less likely to have a pain like dull aching pain like this.
Okay. Okay. So VUR can present even in adulthood. One of the presentation of VUR is completely asymptomatic. So it can present at any age. And we have seen, or it is known, in fact, when you are asked that how the bilateral VUR patient will come, sometimes the patients come in the adolescent or the adulthood with the chronic renal failure as a presentation of VUR. And when you investigate, you find that there is a bilateral hydronephrosis, hydroureter, and do MCU, and you find that there is a gross grade 5 reflux. So VUR will come and present at in the childhood, in the neonatal period, or it can remain asymptomatic. So VUR can happen, can present anyway. So remember that, keep that in mind. All right. So in this case, you want to have some negative history, and that's a negative history. History of fever, no history of fever, nausea, vomiting, hematuria, leuturia, no LUTS, no trauma, no previous surgery. No tuberculosis contact, no weakness, puffiness, no weight loss, nothing. So there is almost nothing in the history. Is the rest of the thing is perfectly all right? No bladder bowel problem. Is married with one child, vegetarian diet. And let me tell you on examination now is that general examination is perfectly okay. There is nothing great in that. He's just a young adult. On systemic examination, there is no tenderness. Left kidney is palpable. Is below the 3 to 4 centimeters the costal margin. It's a 10 cystic in nature. Well-defined margins, moving well with respiration, and it is bilateral. So anything else you want to know?
Sir, is there any history of any family history of a renal disease or a renal cystic disease in the family?
No, why you want to ask that?
Sir, if the patient is having a large renal cyst or a polycystic kidney, he can present with...
Okay, so that's fine. Okay. Anything else you want to know?
Sir, regarding patient has any complaints of abdominal fullness, sir, or constipation history, sir?
No constipation. He has a vague fullness of abdomen on the left side, which is for 1 month only.
Sir, does he give any history related to details crisis, like when he takes a binge of water?
Nothing.
Any renal angle tenderness?
No tenderness. No fever, no renal angle tenderness, nothing.
So any history of previous treatment for pulmonary tuberculosis?
No.
Anyway, sir, palpable bladder micturition pattern of the patient, sir?
No, he has no complaints of LTS. Bladder is not palpable. Other kidney is not palpable. Other renal angle is completely free.
So this could be a case of, sir, left hydronephrosis, as it is a 10 cystic in nature. So okay. I would like to proceed with the further investigation too, sir.
Right. So now we have finished the history and examination. So what is your differential diagnosis? At this juncture, you have to give differential diagnosis.
First is, sir, left hydronephrosis. Secondary to query PUJ obstruction.
PUJ. Okay.
Could be a parapelvic or renal cystic disease. Large cyst also could be palpable, which can have
okay, large renal cyst. Okay.
ADPKD, although the I will keep in the differential, sir, although the surface would be irregular and not smooth like.
Okay, the ADPKD, you differentiate ADPKD. That the surface will be smooth. Okay, anything else? Anything else? So you have said PUJ, you have said Raj renal cyst, you have said ADPKD, unilateral kidney palpable. Anything else?
Sir, it can be primary obstructive megaureter, sir. Associated primary with any primary obstructive mega ureter.
Okay, anything else?
Sir, any PUJ stone causing hydronephrosis, which is silent, not causing much of pain?
Yeah, so that he said it could be hydronephrosis because of stone or because of the PUJ. That he said. That is possible, very much possible. So, any cause of hydronephrosis is the differential diagnosis. Okay. So I think whatever you have enumerated is acceptable. So how will you proceed in this case?
I would like to get ultrasound KUB with post-void residual of this patient along with blood investigation and CUEs. Blood investigation including CBC and renal function test.
Blood investigation including?
CBC and renal function test.
Renal function test. Okay. So everybody agrees with that?
With the urine routine.
Urine routine, sir.
Urine routine, CBC.
So never jump to ultrasonography as a first investigation. Remember, in urology, whatever is the case, whether it is a clear-cut case of palpable lump, whether it is case, eventually are bound to do ultrasound, but never say ultrasonography as a first investigation. That's a very, very important point. Always go in a very systematic manner, and in urology, first is always urine routine microscopy, because that is going to give you the clue. Now, what is the benefit of urine routine microscopy here? Santosh, you tell me.
Sir, in urine routine microscopy, we can know any signs of infection, whether pus cells are significant number of pus cells are present or not, sir, and any microscopic hematuria if it is present or not.
Okay.
And any proteinuria, sir, if associated proteinuria, either we can know, sir. And any micro crystals of stones, crystalluria, it can be seen, sir.
So urine forms a very important thing. Lots of things can be made out by just doing urine routine microscopic. So go in a very systematic manner. That first is urine, then CBC, and then of course you can do everything. So here is the urine and CBC. Urine is perfectly normal, 2 to 5 WBC, 0 to 2 RBCs. Creatinine is 0.96. Total count hemoglobin is normal. And then you want to do what? Ultrasound. Right? Okay. So, Himanshu, you see this ultrasound and tell me what is your finding.
Sir, on this ultrasound, I can see a kidney is seen. The outline is normal. Parenchymal thickness appears, it appears good. There is a central dilatation, which is indicative of hydronephrosis. And so the, I think the ureter can, the proximal ureter can also, I am not able to make out, sir, about the ureter.
Yeah, so that I agree that unless and until you actually do yourself, ultrasonography is a very static investigation. If you have not provided the representative plates, you cannot really make out. Anything seen in a different angle will give a different interpretation. So either you would like to see all the plates or you would like to see the report. Okay. So left kidney is grossly hydronephrotic, which in a parenchymal thickness is better in the lower pole, but in upper pole it is not all that good. Pelvis is big and extrarenal, multiple lower calcium stone seen, ureter not visualized, right kidney normal, bladder normal. So Himanshu, what next you want?
Sir, the ureter is not visualized.
Yeah, ureter not visualized.
Yes, sir. Sir, in this patient I would like to go ahead with the I have still not ruled out the stone, so I would like to go ahead with the CT KUV.
Okay, you want to do CT, plain CT KUV, not the CT IVP. Yes. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, plain CT KUV.
Why plain CT you want to do?
Sir, because if there is any stone, I will be able to pick that up. Then in case of a other differentials were huge obstruction or large renal cyst.
Suppose if you see the stone, then are you not interested in finding out the function of this kidney when it is palpable kidney? Dilated, palpable, grossly hydronephrotic kidney. Are you not interested? Why are you asking only NCCT? In a case of a stone, what is the indication of doing only NCCT?
Sir, if it's a ureteric stone, NCCT could suffice.
If it is a ureteric stone, NCCT will suffice. Okay. Vijay, do you agree with his statement?
Sir, first for this case, I would like to do CT urography. Second for
No. First, you answer him that if it is a ureteric stone, then you are happy with the NCCT. Is that correct statement?
Sir, if it is isolated ureteric stone, we can go for NCCT KUV. Or if it is a small renal pelvic stone, less than a centimeter, then also we can go ahead with the CT KUV play.
Okay. Santosh, you agree?
Sir, in this already, most of the anatomical details which are required, sir, since there are multiple lower calcium stones, sir, along with gross
height. We are not asking this case. The statement what he made, that if it is a ureteric stone, then NCCT is sufficient.
Sir, in this, I would like to go for contrast NCCT, sir, or CT urogram.
No, you are not mistaken. We are not asking in this case.
Okay.
I'm asking you that suppose there is a case of a ureteric stone, then is your investigation of choice NCCT or CTIVP?
NCCT is
sufficient. That is wrong. You have not understood the guidelines. NCCT is to be done when along with the ultrasonography finding. Suppose there is a ureteric stone with gross hydronephrosis and hydroureter with in-out parenchyma. Obviously, it is not a case for NCCT. So just don't go by the idea that ureteric stone means NCCT. Ureteric stone with ultrasonography showing only mild hydronephrosis and quite a good thick parenchyma, good sized kidney, then I can agree that it is only NCCT that is investigation of choice. But if you are asked that ureteric stone, but you don't know whether that ureteric stone has caused gross hydronephrosis and thin parenchyma or not, in that case, syncytiasis is not a correct answer. It is the wrong answer. Okay. So qualify your statement by what you are answering. Okay. So coming back to this case, Santosh, will you advise? You said that you want to do CT IVP, not the plain CT, right? In this case.
Sir, in this case, usually most of the findings anatomical is based on this, sir. I can say it is mostly PUGO, sir. Though I am not able to visualize the ureter, since there are mostly secondary stones because multiple lower calcium stones are seen along with gross hydronephrosis.
What will you do in this case?
So I would like to go for a functional study, sir. I would like to do DTPA cancer in this case.
You want to do DTPA? Okay.
Yes.
Right. So you don't want to do any CT or anything. You just want to go to DTPA.
Yes. All
right. So Pramod, you agree with both of them or you have any third angle?
No, sir. I want to do a CT urography, sir, in this case.
Okay. So one person is saying plain CT, one person is saying CT IVP, and one person is saying DTPA. So let us see what fourth person is saying.
Sir, for functional assessment of obstruction, I would do DTPA renogram. For anatomical detail, I will do CT urography.
Okay, fantastic. So he wants to do both. So all answers are different. So let us see now in a case like this, what is your objective and how do you come to your objective? So Santosh, you said that you want to do a DTPA radiogram because you want to basically assess the function, right?
Yes. Yes, sir.
So in your differential diagnosis, you were saying that there could be a PUJ stone causing hydronephrosis. So how do you rule out the PUJ stone or a stone just below the PUJ?
So if it is a PUJ stone, sir, mostly it can be impacted stone or it can be free stone, sir. If it is only because of PUJ, there will be mostly multiple secondary stones, sir, which are smooth and rounded, sir.
Yeah, that I agree. But how are you sure that it is not an impacted small stone at the PUJ which has given rise to this sort of a problem? Can you rule out that in the DTPA?
DTPA only we can rule out obstruction, sir, actually.
So how do you rule out the PUJ stone?
For that we need to do CT urogram, sir.
All right. Okay. So my question to Vijay,
sir,
is that is ultrasonography not sufficient enough to say whether there is a PUJ stone or impacted PUJ stone or not? Or you still want to do CT scan? You said you want to do both.
Sir, ultrasonography is suggestive of but not confirmatory. CT urography will give better anatomical details. Plus, it can give details of whether there is any duplicated system as the ultrasound is showing more thinning on the upper pole rather than the lower pole. So it could be duplication also, plus secondary PUJ. So I would do CT urography plus GTP.
All right. So in a case like this, what is your objective is to? First is to diagnose what exactly is the condition. And secondly, when you diagnose the condition, what is the functional status of the kidney? Now, coming back to the question to Himanshu.
Yes,
no, who said DTPA? Santosh, you said DTPA. No?
Yes, sir.
Now, when you have this kidney, which is table, which is 4 cm, you see that there is a gross hydronephrosis and thin parenchyma. Suppose we accept your diagnosis that it is a PUJ obstruction. No, there is no stone which is visualized on sonography, and you take it for granted that it's a PUJ obstruction. How reliable is the DTPA from the functional assessment in a case where there is a usually palpable dilated kidney and gross hydronephrosis on sonography?
Sir, in this case, since it is a very gross hydronephrotic kidney, sir, there are chances that we can give false positive reports also, sir, in this, based on DTPA scan, sir.
So why did you do DTPA then? If it is going to give wrong impression, what's the logic?
So one thing is when we are doing DTPSR, we will give Lasixer along while doing DTPSR.
Yeah.
So that can that will help us to overcome this problem, sir, actually.
So if you have a grossly hydronephrotic kidney completely palpable, can the false positive can be overcome by giving Lasix? Because Lasix is part and parcel of the DTPSR study. Lasix is given in every case.
Then
how do you overcome the false positive result which you mentioned?
So ideally, in this case, we should do EC renography or MAG3 renography if available, because it is not much dependent on the function of the kidney. So, and extraction of the MAG3 and EC is better than DTPS. So, EC or MAG3.
No, whatever you want to do, you have to understand that isotope study in a grossly dilated system is always a problem.
Yes.
So now how to overcome this problem is that these questions will keep on coming in exam, and examiner will always question you. If you say CT-IVP, the examiner is going to ask you why not DTPA. And if you say DTPA, examiner is going to ask you why not CT-IVP. So you have to be very clear in your mind as to how you are going to give answer. So answer to that, especially in the background of this case, is that he has got a grass hydronephrosis, which you have seen on sonography. He has got multiple stones, which are likely to be secondary stones, as you said, that they are in the lower calyx. But you don't know whether it is a PUJ obstruction, whether there is any small stone or not. Because sometimes it has been seen that the patient who has a very small stone, but which is impacted over a long time, patient can present like this. Okay. So here you want to do a functional study as well as the anatomical study. And in a PUJ, especially if there is a kinking of the ureter, and if the bowel preparation is not good, if there is a lot of gas in the bowel, you can always miss that stone in the upper ureter on the sonography.
Yes.
If this was a case in a 3-year-old child and he has presented like this, obviously you would have not gone for CT scan, because the commonest thing in the children is a PUJ obstruction. Now, PUJ obstruction at 26-year-old age, you have to think of some other causes also, because then stones become common thing. And if there was a significant PUJ, very few patients they present and in the adulthood. Rest of the patients, majority will present in the childhood. So your differential what exactly is and how much is the chance that he's having stone, depending on that, you should ask for the investigation. So I agree in this case that CT-IVP is a good investigation of choice for two reasons. We understand that sonography is the anatomical, will give anatomical problem, and DTPA is going to give you functional aspect. But if you combine these two, IVP gives you both. It will give you the anatomy, CT-IVP, as well as it will give you the functional anatomy. Only thing DTPA what is going to give is that whether you can assess in the follow-up period and other things is perfectly okay. But CT scan, if you do CT-IVP, it doesn't mean that CT-IVP is not going to give you the functional assessment. It is bound to give you functional assessment, okay? So I will agree in this case that the CT-IVP is the investigation of a choice if you are given. So I'll show you the CT-IVP picture. And so see this CT-IVP, Himanshu.
Yes, sir.
You see this CT-IVP and tell me what is your finding.
Sir, in the plain films, I can see that the left kidney is grossly hydronephrotic with a thin rim of parenchyma present at the periphery. And there are multiple lower calyceal stones which are visible, almost 3 to 6 in number.
Okay.
And it is grossly hydronephrotic crossing the midline. Sir, I would like to see the contrast images, sir.
Okay, all right. So let me tell you that this is the thin rim. As you come into the lower pole, the parenchyma is a little better, but there are multiple stones which are floating everywhere. And this seems to be the whole pelvis. The kidney is sitting like a cup here. it has got a gross hydronephrosis. The whole bulge is there on the, you can see here, that this is what is the palpable part and this is what is the thing. So I will give you the report. So you can see the report.
So one question is there.
Charger.
So I have one question.
Yeah, please, sir, go ahead.
Sir, in this patient, because it was a gross hydronephrotic kidney, and yes, I was anticipating that we could get such a picture. So that's why I opted for a plain CT, and then, you know, based on the thickness of the parenchyma that is there, I was planning to go ahead with a DTPA if required later on. Is that not a is that an approach to be followed, or?
So when you are doing a CT IVP when creatinine is 0.96, what is the big difference between plain CT and CT IVP? As such, you are sending the patient for CT scan. The radiation which you are going to add by one more contrast injection is not all that significant in a patient like this. And if at all you want to do DTPA, you can always do DTPA later on. If you get on CT scan a very nice, good functional this, then you know that you may not even go for DTPA isotope study, right? So if you assume that everything is non-functioning and you have to go for DTPA, it's a different thing. But if you have the significant parenchyma and if you have a significant excretion, then your job is done. Your diagnosis, your functional assessment, your everything is done. Then what is required for follow-up and whether you do DTPA scan or not is a completely different discussion altogether. But your diagnosis is made like that. Okay. So when you are doing already plain CT, I don't think there is any harm or there is any discussion about not giving contrast, especially in a case like this.
Right.
So let me just make it clear that in this case, there is a normal functioning right kidney. No evidence of any obstruction. Left side gross hydronephrosis with marked ballooning of the left renal pelvis due to POJ obstruction, and mild concentration of the contrast skin on the left side, multiple non-obstructive left renal calculi present. Okay. All right. So what next you want to do?
Sir, one more small doubt, sir. Can I ask, sir?
Yes.
Sir, in the scenario previously, we are suspecting that there could be impacted stone in the upper ureter or the PUG, sir,
yeah,
which can lead to this condition. So, in that condition, patient can be painless for so long, sir.
Yeah, it can. See, that's what. Many times you have seen the patients with Stavon also will come with completely asymptomatic or just a vague pain. Patient with PUJ can remain like this for quite a long time. Patients with impacted stone in the PUJ can be like this. Patients with ureteric stone also have come with non-functioning and completely asymptomatic. And then you see the kidney and then you do investigations and they are non-functioning. So it can be asymptomatic. It all depends. See, symptoms of obstruction and the symptoms of obstruction depend on how gradual is the obstruction and whether there is any superadded infection or not. If there is no superadded infection, then the gradual obstruction patient may not even feel that there is obstruction. Okay.
Okay.
So now what next will you do? Okay, Vijay, what is your next step?
Sir, I would like to assess the functional assessment and a differential function of the both the kidneys. I want to see, sir.
Okay, you want to do differential assessment of function. Everybody, yes, agree for that?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So let me show you this functional assessment. You see the graph. You see this chart. So are you able to see on your screen?
Case. So the diagnosis would be left PUJ obstruction with probably left non-functioning kidneys.
So what will you do?
In this case, salvage is not an option. Salvaging the kidney is not an option.
So you will do nephrectomy in this case?
If the patient is complaining that he's symptomatic and...
Whatever symptoms you have heard, he has got a vague pain, discomfort, which he is not taking any medication. You all discuss all that history.
So, patient is, pain is not severe enough, he does not require analgesics. Yeah. So I can keep the patient in the follow-up also and see if there is any worse. Of the
there are two options. One to me, because it's not symptomatic, keep under observation. So these two options with you. No.
Sir, considering the anatomical picture, which showed some good parenchyma in the lower core, but the DTP is showing 11%. So I'll go for I'll try to put a PCN first. I'll wait for 6 weeks repeat a DTP again.
So that is your approach.
I'll see whether the split function is improving or not. So, and then I'll try to salvage it.
In this case, you will put a PCN and then do assessment. Okay. So
this good parenchyma which is in the low, I will try to do PCN initially. Then I would like to the
different opinions have come from all the exam going students. One is saying that we should do PCN and reassess. One is saying that either nephrectomy or observation. One is saying definitely nephrectomy. And what is the other option? Again, Santosh, what you said?
So, same, sir. PCN will keep, sir. Reassess later again.
Okay. So two students are saying PCN and reassessment. Okay. Now let us see one by one. First and foremost, Vijay, this patient is 100% not for observation. Just because he is asymptomatic does not mean that you just continue observation. Once he has come to you, that means there is definitely a treatment which you have found out something, certainly needs treatment. Okay, yes. Technically, at present, he has some pain. Now, forget, suppose this was a completely asymptomatic patient. And he has come to you for some other purpose, and you have done sonography and you have found out all these things. Still, in that case, this patient is not for observation. 100% certain treatment is required. Now, what is that certain, whether it is nephrectomy or something else, we have to decide. Okay. Now, coming back to your other point, that this patient on the basis of 11.5% function, he qualifies for nephrectomy. Now, in that case, we have to discuss that, how do you decide a patient, say 20 years old age, for the nephrectomy in a suspected case of PUJ or a clear-cut case of PUJ? Now, non-functioning of the kidney is decided by not one single factor, okay? Non-functioning of the kidney is decided by several factors, and if you put all factors together, and all factors are unfavorable, then you conclude that this kidney is non-functioning. All right. Because since it is a young patient, he still has to live for another 60 years or 50 years. You have to save as much parenchyma as possible. Nephrectomy can be optioned or can be treatment anytime in future also. But at this juncture, you have to be 100% certain whether it is functioning or not. So how do you decide whether this kidney is functioning or not? So apart from the DTP, renogram is clearly going in favor of poor function and no function at all. So I agree with you that if if you have to really decide on the basis of DTPA, Renogra, and forgetting everything, this patient qualifies for nephrectomy. Now, what are the other factors which you have to decide? First and foremost, that in all this time, patient has not got any urinary tract infection. Secondly, the person, even at present also, in spite of having stones and other things, he does not have any urinary tract infection. There is no history of any hematuria or anything. Thirdly, that those are the aspects in the history. Next, the on the examination, this is a kidney which is a tense kidney. It was written in the history that it is a tense firm cystic swelling. That means this kidney is tense and it is under pressure. Okay, so the kidney which is under pressure is quite a tense kidney is different. If I had told you that, okay, vague kidney is palpable, flabby, there is some lump-like swelling is there and vaguely it is palpable. And on sonography, you see a gross hydronephrosis, not bulging like on the CT scan, the bulging, the way it has, it is bulging. If it is a flabby hydronephrosis, then I would have accepted that, okay, this kidney is completely non-functional. Thirdly, whenever there is a variable parenchyma, it implies that the obstruction which is there has not caused uniform destruction of the parenchyma. At some places, the parenchyma is still left. And if the obstruction is relieved, that parenchyma still can take over and the start functioning. Okay. Another important factor which all of you have missed and which is extremely important is to find out what is the size of the other kidney. If the other kidney has already gone into compensatory hypertrophy, if this kidney was completely non-functioning over a period of time, and if that kidney has taken over and from 10 centimeter size, it has become 12 or 13 centimeter size, that means the already compensatory hypertrophy has taken place, then you can consider that, okay, this kidney now, even if you technically relieve the obstruction, there is no stimulus for this kidney to undergo hypertrophy and recover the function. So all these factors are to be considered before labeling this kidney to be non-functioning or not. And therefore, I will agree with Himanshu and Santosh that this kidney definitely requires a reassessment because there are certain factors in favor of salvage and certain factors against. Renogram is totally against, but as you know, there are so many fallacies. It can be false positive, it can be false negative. In a grossly obstructed kidney, whatever renogram you do, whichever dye, whichever this you use, there are flaws in the interpretation. Okay, so in this case, I would tend to agree that there is nothing lost in putting a nephrostomy and then reassessing whether this kidney is functioning or not. Okay, so this is how you have to tell in exam. Because if you tell that I want to salvage this kidney, they are going to ask you why you want to salvage, on what basis you decide that. And like that, if you say that I will straight away go for nephrectomy, then they will ask all these questions. So this has to be kept in mind when you are answering the case like this. Okay. So now let us come to this, that you want to put a PCN. Okay, Santosh, you said that you want to put a PCN and you want to assess. Yes. Okay, yes, so now tell me, how will you do PCN in this case? Tell me the steps of PCN in this case. This is a grossly hydronephrotic palpable kidney. Wherever you put a probe, it is the kidney which is going to be seen. So yes, how will you do it?
Sir, in this case, it is already large gross hydronephrotic kidney, sir. So yeah. I'll put the PC, I'll take the patient for PCN under local anesthesia in prone position, sir. And okay. Preferably, if I have ultrasound, I'll put under ultrasound guided PCN, sir.
Right. Okay. This and anything else? Any calyx of your choice, or in this case, it does not matter.
Yeah, sir. In this case, we are not able to see, so we to put blind PCN, sir.
Okay. Good. Okay.
And I will. Okay.
Yeah, what you said?
No, post operatively. Yes, post procedure. No,
post procedure is okay. I'm just discussing the technique of PCN. Okay, Pramod, you said that you want to put a PCN.
Yes, sir.
So,
yes,
is your technique different than what he has said, or you will do a few different things?
Sir, being an elective thing, sir, I like to do under anesthesia, sir. Even though the patient is asymptomatic, grossly dilated, okay. I'll do under anesthesia, spinal or JGA. Okay. It will be done in slightly left tilted position with ultrasound guidance, and my preferred calyx will be lower calyx, sir, because there is a good parenchyma where in grossly dilated system, once you put a PCN, once the system collapses, there is a chance that the PCN tube may slip off. So it will be better to put in a lower calyx, sir.
Okay. So that is what you want to do it. Okay. Anything else apart from what you have described about the choice of calyx and anesthesia position?
Yes, sir. One more thing. There was no, sir. Better. I'll prefer to put in a lower calyx. That's it, sir.
Okay. All right. So I think all your description is completely is grossly incomplete. If you give only this much description, when I ask you that describe how would you do PCN in this case, it is grossly incomplete answer. Now, what things you have missed is, and what is expected from the from you in exam is that anesthesia, everything is fine, but when you in this case the choice of calyx is really immaterial. What point you said is that is correct, that in a grossly autonephrotic kidney the tube can slip, and to counter that you have to put excessive tube inside so that it does not slip out. But what is more important is that when you
once I put my needle, I'll confirm whether once I puncture the kidney, I'll confirm whether the system is like the urine is clear or it's infected. And I'll, even though the patient is asymptomatic, I'll send the urine sample for culture.
Okay.
And as it is a dilated system, so I won't try to pass any contrast or force any contrast. If I do that, it will lead to chances of infection due to pyelovenous or pyelolymphatic.
We can see with the what pressure it is coming, sir, that fluid, whether it is coming under high pressure or low pressure, the fluid which is coming.
So I think that's a very, very important point, and that is what I was driving your attention to, that in the exam, all these points should be told. That when you put a puncture needle, at what pressure the fluid is coming out? If it is a flabby kidney, you have to actually aspirate the fluid. It is not going to come out against the gravity like that. But once you put the puncture in a prone position, and if it is coming by force, then you know that there is a lot of pressure in the system, and that's a very good sign. Now tell me, Santosh, you said that you want to see the pressure. Why this pressure is such a important thing? Why do you say that if it is a good pressure, the system is kidney is likely to be functioning, and if the pressure is less, then it is unlikely to be functioning? Why this high and low pressure, from where it comes?
So this urine is already under tension, sir, in the pelvic calcium system. But in between, since patient...
That is bound to happen in every case of obstruction, no?
Yes, sir.
So, Pramod, you want to say anything?
Sir, we have two types of PUJ. So one is volume dependent, one is pressure dependent. The pressure dependent PUJ, they have a good chance of recoverability, sir. So if I'm getting a good pressure once I put my initial puncture needle, so I think that this kidney could be salvageable, sir.
No, you are not given the answer that why is this such a pressure is such a important determining factor. We are not discussing PUJ. This is true for any, even if it is a stone which is obstructing and hydronephrosis is there, the pressure is always important factor. So what is this pressure such an important factor?
So low pressure,
if it is poorly functioning, where the pressures they go down?
So because of the persistence of the pacemaker cells, which help in peristalsis, these will create increased pressure. Sir. This can be proved that it can be a recovery kidney, sir.
In functional kidney, sir, the kidney will be producing urine. In a case of complete obstruction, so the more urine will be coming, it will be giving pressure. In case of a non-functioning kidney, there will be no filtration, no urine will be pouring out. So
low pressure means that it's already decompensated kidney. So the chance of
recovery will be less. So what do you mean by decompensated? That point I agree with you. That is, you are coming to a correct answer. You are coming very near. So what do you mean by decompensated?
So that means that it's a long-standing obstruction and the because of the long-standing...
No, any PUJ is a long-standing. PUJ is since birth. Whether it is any case of PUJ, if it is 27 years, it is bound to be long-standing. We are not discussing that. We are discussing the salvageability. Pressure is not going to decide whether it is long-standing or recent origin. So let us cut short the discussion. What you are saying is correct, that peristalsis does not play any role in the creation of the pressure. But if it is if the decompensated obstruction is there, what does it mean? That whenever there is a gradual obstruction, the pylovenous and pylolymphatic channels will open up. And that whatever urine which is produced in the pelvic cholesterol system is going to be taken up by the pylovenous and a pylolymphatic flow. And therefore, over a period of time, if you read the pathophysiology of obstruction, over a period of time, the pressure in the system will go down. Now, there are two things. Because the pressure is taken up by the pylovenous and pylolymphatic flow, it is the body mechanism to salvage the renal parenchyma by reducing the pressure and opening the outflow. However, if there is a persistent obstruction, there is a limit to which the pressures can be reduced, and then the parenchyma will become thin, kidney becomes flabby, and it becomes non-functioning. Very fact that there is a pressure in the system, which means that the obstruction, in spite of being long-standing for 27 years, it has still not opened up the pylovenous and pylolymphatic flow. There is an intermittent obstruction across the PUJ. PUJ by definition is the intermittent partial obstruction. It is never a complete obstruction. And the amount of urine which is flowing across the PUJ is still sufficient enough for urine to be driven out from the PUJ, and the pressure in the system is still more. So that is a very important factor to assess. Okay, so now you have put a PCN needle and the pressure has come with the high pressure. And it's a clear urine. You have sent for culture. Culture subsequently has come negative. It's a very clear, transparent urine. You have put a 14-number Mallard catheter. And suddenly, lot of urine, almost 1 liter of urine has drained down. So now, Vijay, you tell me, in the post-operative period, what things you will observe in this case?
Sir, I will observe the urine output from the PCN. Color. Okay. Of the urine, and I will send for urine analysis also and see specific gravity of the urine.
When do you do that? Next day?
No, sir. After a week period.
After 1 week?
1 week.
Why you want to do after 1 week? Why not 2 weeks?
Yeah, to see, sir, that there is an improvement in the function of the, if there is any parenchyma left and it is concentrating the urine.
So that assessment, do you do serial at 1 week or 2 weeks?
No, sir. The assessment will be serial urine analysis, sir.
Serial.
Along with the output monitoring.
So you will first monitor the output. So yes. Say that first and foremost, I will monitor the output, how much output is there. It is possible suddenly there is 1 liter output has come. Next day it is 400, third day it is 100, and fourth day it is 50. And it is remain 50. So obviously you don't need any further investigation. Okay,
yes, sir.
This kidney is clearly non-functioning. This was just a tense urinary, it's a ballooning thing, and it is gone. So no further evaluation is required. You know that it is a straight away non-functioning kidney. Now various things have gone in that favor. So important thing is to assess the daily urine output. Okay, so now tell me, that you have put a nephrostomy and daily urine output in this patient, first day on the table itself was 1 liter. Subsequently, every day the output is 1 liter in every 24 hours, and 7 days are over. So now, what will you do in this case? Santosh, you tell me.
Sir, in this I would like to check for serum that electrolytes through the urine, sir, and I would like to look for the osmolarity serially, sir. If this osmolarity
So what things you want to check in that urine? You want to say osmolarity, okay?
Then yes, what sir. Osmolarity, sodium, and pH,
urinary
sir.
Urinary sodium and pH, sir.
And if pH. If this is equal to that of the serum, sir, then mostly it could be a non-functional kidney only, though the kidney has lost its concentrating ability, sir.
Okay. So osmolarity, that means you want to check the specific gravity of the urine, right?
Yes, sir.
Then you want to check the urinary sodium, which is going to give you the idea how much is the ability for the
urine to chloride also,
sodium. Sodium, yes. Chloride, okay. Okay, so how do you check the specific gravity of the urine? So Pramod, how do you check specific gravity of the urine?
So in this case, it will be a 24-hour sample, sir.
Okay. And you want to check 24 hours collected sample for specific gravity?
For specific gravity and for rest of the thing, even the spot sodium and creatinine clearance.
Why you want 24 hours collected sample?
It will be, I'll prefer to do it at 3 weeks, sir, not at 1 week, sir. I'll give time for the kidney to recover.
That's okay. We are not discussing at present when you do all this. But whenever you want to do it, why you want to collect 24 hour sample? If you want to check specific gravity in any patient, do you collect 24 hours urine and then check it, or you check it on the spot?
For any other patient, sir, we check it on the spot, sir.
How come this patient is different? So why this patient is a different criteria? Yeah, Himanshu, you want to say anything?
Sorry, sir.
Vijay, you want to, do you know when do you check and how do you check specific gravity? Okay, so this patient, the most important bedside checking before you sending this patient for urinary sodium and measuring the how much is the milliosmoles of this and all HiFi investigation, first and foremost is checking of pH and checking of the specific gravity. No, ultrasound is okay. Ultrasound is very important. You are right. To see whether the whole kidney is collapsed or not. Because sometimes if you have a less output, say for example, first day, second day, the output was 1 liter. Now it has become 100 ml or 200 ml. You have to check whether there is any adenonephrosis or not, whether there is any untapped calyx or not. Sometimes you have a different calyx. Especially if you are doing for stone, then you have to check whether there is any residual hydronephrosis or not, or if the whole kidney is collapsed or not. If there is a duplex, which all of you were raising the doubt, whether there is any duplex system which is not being connected and whether it is there or not. So all these things have to be checked on sonography, because you don't put contrast in a such a dilated kidney. All right. So that is okay. So ultrasound has been done. The whole kidney is completely collapsed. And now we are checking the specific gravity and pH. So pH and specific gravity is a bedside measurement. There is no need of 24 hours checking. The specific gravity and pH, how do you check? Either you check the spot sample and compare with the urethral sample, which is a normal sample, which is coming from the other kidney, and see how much is the difference. Or you keep patient nil by mouth, and then check whether this kidney is concentrating or not. If you starve the patient, your pH is should normally become acidic, and your specific gravity has to increase. If that increase is reflected on the urethral sample, and if that is not reflected in the nephrostomy sample, which implies decides that this kidney is just pouring the simple plain water and the concentrating ability of the kidney is gone. Now, why you want to see the concentrating ability of the kidney and not all the other exchanges, bicarbonates and sodium and chloride and all these things, is because the first to return, whenever the return of the function starts, the first is the concentration ability of the kidney which comes back. And therefore, first thing to return is whether urine is able to concentrate or not. So all these things can be checked on the bedside examination. And I agree with Santosh that urinary sodium, urinary chloride, and you always check that with the urethral sample. Don't just check the only nephrostomy sample, because the results which you are going to get, you may not be able to interpret. But if you compare with the normal kidney, then you can definitely interpret. Okay. So that is how you check in the follow-up whether this kidney really is picking up the function or not. Now, next question is that at what interval you want to do all this checking? Now, tell me, when will you do it? Santosh, you said 1 week. So, Vijay, do you agree that 1 week is the correct time to evaluate this thing? Patient is having 1 liter output per day in 24 hours per day.
Sir, ideally, it should be a serial monitoring. With the adequate amount of interval, 1 week or 10 days interval in between the samples.
You will keep on doing?
Sir, up to 3 to 4 weeks, I will sample and see.
So every week you want to do for 4 weeks. All right.
Yes, sir. Okay. Because Himanshu,
do you agree with that?
Sir, at least we should wait for 2 to 3 weeks before checking the specific cavity, because it was a long-standing obstruction. And though the urine output is there, if it is coming good, we have to wait for the kidney to return to its normal function. If there is any, we should wait for at least 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay. All right. Now, I want to ask you, what is the logic of waiting for all this time?
Sir, initial period, there could be post-obstructive diuresis also. The kidney may go into physiological post-obstructive
diuresis. Yeah, that I agree. But that is over. That is over. So I am telling you that 7 days are over and it is fixed 1 liter output. So there is no question of post-obstructive diuresis. Right. So that stage is gone. So that is agreed. That post-operative diuresis phase, you don't want to check anything. That is correct. See, let us not waste time. How do you decide when to, because this is a very critical question which will come into the exam and even in your practice, that when do you do all this test? So the question is that after the end of the 1 week, you have to assess in your mind as to where are you actually going ahead. Suppose it is having a 1 liter of output, which is not a bad output. If patient has 1.5 liters output from urethral and 1 liter output from this kidney, it is not a bad output. It is having almost same output as the other kidney. That one important aspect which you have to see. And at this juncture, you have to decide as to which way you are actually going ahead. Are you tilting towards nephrectomy or not? Or whether you are treating your treatment option to a repair of PUJ or not. Now, at this juncture, even though the kidney is not completely recovered, and even though there are chances that kidney further will go into recovery and other things, it may take 5 weeks, it may take 6 weeks, it may take 2 months, it may take 3 months, but you can't keep on waiting like that. So if you discuss with the patient, and in your mind, if you decide that, okay, 1 liter output, even if it is low concentrated urine, and at this age group of a patient, I want to give him the chance of the recovery further, and I want to repair the PUJ, which is not such a big deal, then there is no point in waiting. Now you have proved that it is 1 liter output, then you don't have to wait for the 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks. Okay. So in what way your balance is sitting, you have to gain. However, suppose this patient had the stone, is a 70 years old male, and the output is 1 liter, the other kidney is also 1.5 liters. Now, the stone treatment itself is going to be a complex stone treatment, a Sagan stone with multiple this, and it is a borderline kidney functioning, then you can say that I would still like to wait, because here my balance is not tilting towards the salvage of this kidney. And if DTPA is showing 11% and this is that, then even if it is 1 liter output, I don't want to save that output, because the treatment is hazardous. It is likely to cause the persistent chronic infection, and after that is a problem. So I will go ahead with nephrectomy. So you can go ahead with nephrectomy even at this point of time. Okay. Suppose you are still not sure whether you are really going to nephrectomy or going to repair or not, then you are justified in telling that, okay, I would like to further wait and really confirm whether this kidney is really worth the salvaging or not. And then I will take a call at the end of 3 weeks or 4 weeks and then explain to the patient that it is not worth salvaging. Or if you really see that there is definite improvement, then I will advise accordingly that, okay, it is worth salvaging. Okay. So this call you have to take, and this is how you need to explain a personalized evaluation when you put a PPM. These are the things which you have to check, and this is how you tell in the exam. Now when you are telling here that I want to, my balance is tilting towards the salvaging this kidney, what are the factors you consider? It is only just the output which you consider? Still your specific gravity, still your pH is not in favor. They are just a very low specific gravity there. So how do you say that I will advise use a repair? Is it the only output which you see, or anything else?
So output, and again we'll do ultrasound, sir. Then we'll check for the parenchyma of the kidney.
Okay, that is very good. So I want to see after the collapse of the kidney, how the kidney is looking, whether it is echogenic or not, whether it is having a nice good parenchyma. It cannot be nice, but it is, if it is sufficient parenchyma or not. Very good. Yeah. That's an important point. Anything else?
And sir, we'll repeat the diuretic renal scintigraphy, sir, after 3 weeks, sir, with clamping of PCN tube.
No, that is okay. That you can do creatinine clearance, you can do diuretic. We are not discussing that. What we are discussing is that clinically, how you are going towards the salvage of the kidney. In diuretic, even if it is same, I say that it is 11.5, but still on clinical parameters, you want to save the kidney. So what are those parameters? See, these cases have to be individualized. There is no one fixed treatment that, okay, this is where, do nephrectomy. If it is there, do pyeloplasty. It is not like that. Every case has to be individualized. And what is important from the examiner point of view is that, have you really understood as to on what ground you are going to decide whether it is repair or whether it is ablation? So one aspect you said that, okay, output. Other aspect you said is the assessment of kidney on sonography.
And regarding the shape of the PUJ, sir, whether it is funnel shaped in the dependent position or not, sir. If it is...
PUJ is not going to be dependent. It's a huge dilated this. So that PUJ you assess only on the CT scan. Now, after collapse of the kidney, you can't assess PUJ. Now, one more aspect I want you to tell. If you are not telling, then I can tell. But anybody wants to guess?
Whether it is intrarenal or extrarenal perfusion?
Yes, that is another important point. Very good.
Whether the symptoms of patients have totally gone, sir. He was having a mild
symptoms,
pain.
Yeah, the symptoms are bound to go. So that's okay. Symptoms are bound to go. Now, okay. So important thing is that whether there is any infection or not. If in a patient who has got a sterile or the uninfected hydronephrosis, the recovery is better and recovery is full. Whereas if there is an element of infection, say for example, you said culture, which is the urine which has come out is a turbid urine, or is a pyonephrotic or pus which has come out, or urine is turbid. And even when you are seeing 1 liter output, but intermittently it is all turbid urine which is coming out. Now that definitely it will tilt your balance to the nephrectomy side, because even after repair, if the kidney is chronically infected, this kidney is not going to be silent. It is the this kidney eventually will cause recurrent episodes of UTI, and that is further going to deteriorate the renal function, and patient is not going to be satisfied. But if your urine is transparent, clear, if the urine which is coming out is clear, your cultures are sterile, then definitely with the same parameters of sodium and of specific gravity on DTPA, you can still go ahead and do salvaging the kidney. Okay. So these are the things which you need to check on examination and this. Okay. Suppose you have decided to salvage this kidney. Is DTPA is done, which is showing a 20% function now. Is sodium, everything is in favor. And now 2 weeks are over, you have decided to salvage. So what sort of operation you will do? Pramod? What type of pyeloplasty you will do? He has got multiple lower cholesterol and scattered stone basically. So what will you do?
Sir, I'll prefer to do an open dismembered Anderson and pyeloplasty. Sir.
Open Hello. Pyeloplasty and at the same time you will take out the stones.
Hello.
Okay. Any other any other opinion?
We can do sir, laparoscopic also.
Okay, you can do laparoscopy. Any other opinion?
Yeah. Other thing is, sir.
All right. So I don't think there is any other option. You can always tell a robotic thing. So basically, it is a pyeloplasty with a removal of the stone. Now, whichever method you are doing, whether it is a laparoscopy or whether it is the open surgery. What precautions you will take when you are doing stone removal? How do you know that stones are completely removed, and what precautions you will take? Because you want to make sure that all stones are out, otherwise it's going to create problem in the post-operative period. In the position, whichever method you are doing, it is not easy to put a siam if you are doing laparoscopy, if you are doing whichever method you are doing, it's not easy. Open surgery, yes, you can definitely do some, but that's a very awkward position, kidney position and all. So how do you ensure?
Intraoperative ultrasound we can use, sir.
Intraoperative ultrasound, yes, that is one method, but intraoperative ultrasound is not all that good because when you do open surgery, it does not give that much of a proper shadowing. Yes. They are all artifacts which will keep on coming. But yes, that is one method which definitely you can do. So in short, what I'm asking you is that enumerate all the methods to ensure that complete stone is all the stones are cleared.
So once I've opened the pelvis, whatever stones I could clear, it's possible. Otherwise, I'll start flushing each and every calyx. If I've got a flexi nephroscope, I'll use a flexi nephroscope also, sir.
Okay, that is good. What else? What else?
And secondly, I'll use under C-arm vision if the completion of the surgery and remove the PCN later after confirming that all the stones are cleared.
Okay. All right. So whatever you have said is all right. Say all these methods have to be adopted. But the most important thing is that now in this situation, is very critical. So you go back to CT scan or you take a plain X-ray and try to see how many stones are there. Sometimes stones can be overlapping and therefore you have to carefully measure how many stones are there. And you should be able to measure because these are round secondary stones which are freely floating into the kidney. So on preoperative X-ray or preoperative CT scan, if you see, they will definitely tell you there are 7 stones or 8 stones, or if you have X-ray in your mind in front of you, you can definitely measure how many stones are there. And accordingly, if you get that much number of stones, and if you adopt all these things, definitely the stone clearance can be completed. All right. So in this case, you have done open pyeloplasty, Anderson Hines pyeloplasty. And you had identified 7 stones, and all 7 stones have been retrieved. You have done flexible nephroscopy. There are no stones which are seen. So now what will you do? Will you put a double J stent? Will you put a nephrostomy? Or you will do primary repair? What is your protocol?
Sir, I'll...
Anybody can...
Yes, sir.
Yeah, who is answering?
Sir, Pramod, yes.
Pramod, you answer.
Sir, I'll keep both the DJ stent and nephrostomy.
Why?
And, so one thing, DJ stent, I'll keep it for 6 weeks. Secondly, being a grossly dilated system where the nephrostomy tube was supposed to be kept, was there for 2 to 3 weeks before there. So I won't remove it in the time of surgery. I'll keep it for next 1 to 2 weeks and then remove later, sir.
Okay, why is that? Why you want to keep nephrostomy and DJ both?
Sir, as there were stones, even though I'm pretty sure that I have removed all the stones, if I missed a stone, then it can come and block my operative area, sir. So better to have a safety nephrostomy inside. This is one thing. And second, it was very...
No, but you have put a DJ stent, no? So that is never going to get blocked. Stone is not going to block the DJ stent. So why you want to keep a nephrostomy?
Sir, the nephrostomy was there for long, so it can... There are chances that there might be some leak. The crack has matured enough. So there are chances there will be some leak. So I'll keep...
So better to remove it, no? So you are giving time for it to heal. So it is better not to keep because
I'll rather give time for my anastomosis to heal, sir. So...
Sir, in this case...
Okay. Yeah, sir, so Himanshu, you want to say something?
Sir, Santosh, sir, myself.
Santosh, sir, you want to say something?
Sir, in this case, already, whether if you have confirmed that all the stones are removed, better I will remove the PCN, sir, because I don't want to make my anastomosis dry, sir. Because of the PCN, no, it will be draining more.
You are keeping a stent, so it is unlikely to become a dry anastomosis. If there is a dry, then you have stented. If it is dry without stented, it's a problem. But if it is a dry with a stent in position, there is no problem.
Can I, sir?
Yes.
Sir, I will retain the PCN tube for some time. I will put the drain also. I will assess if there is any increase in drain output or not. Okay. PCN will help me, sir. If there is a leak or a drain output is increasing, then PCN in situ will help to resolve that urinoma or any collection which is occurring. If there is no increase in urine output, drain output, then I can safely remove the PCN tube.
Sir, I would like
Okay.
So yeah. I would like to keep a stent and a drain while remove the PCN.
Okay. All right. So I think all this answer...
Before removing the PCN tube, sir, I'll clamp the PCN once and maybe for 24 hours and...
Oh, that's okay.
Then
so
I look for whether the patient is having any symptoms or not.
Basically, what are the indications of putting a nephrostomy? In a case of a pyeloplasty along with the DJ stent, is that if there was a previous pyonephrosis, that you want to keep a nephrostomy even postoperatively, that is one. Secondly, if it was a grossly hydronephrotic, still you want to keep a nephrostomy because you want to give a trial of clamping and see whether it is kidney is collapsing, whether this DJ stent is sufficient enough to drain that grossly hydronephrotic kidney or not. And that is the purpose of keeping a nephrostomy. Thirdly, whenever there are stones, that is one of the indications of putting nephrostomy. Why? Because if you see on the post-operative period that there is a stone, you already have a track in position and you can always create a low pressure by putting an amplatz and take out that stone. You don't have to do a second surgery after 6 weeks or so. And it is not going to affect your this. You are not going to go on the second day or third day. You can keep it for 7 days, and after 7 days, the tract is mature with a low pressure. You just have to pick up that stone. It's a pickup stone. See, so that's a missed stone. So these are all advantages. And secondly, the nephrostomy and DJ is to be kept in a case of when you are doing redo pyeloplasty, because there is always a problem of anastomosis, problem of leakage. In case of excessive drain, in case of any problem, nephrostomy can be opened up. Anastomosis remains dry. and the stent is there, so healing is far, far better. And that's the reason why you want to keep a nephrostomy along with the DJ. But as Santosh pointed out, it is always necessary, if you are keeping a nephrostomy open, to put a double J stent. If you do not put the double J stent, then the anastomosis will become dry and that will form the synechiae, and then it will cause the post-operative PUJ obstruction because of the synechiae formation and the fibrosis. Okay. So these are all technical things which you need to know. Now you said you want to put a drain. Suppose you have kept a drain and you have not kept nephrostomy, double J stent is kept, and there is an excessive drain in the post-operative period. Drain is draining 500 ml urine. So what will you do?
I will retain the catheter and the drain, sir, and I will monitor
drain, catheter, peripheral catheter is there, DJ stent is there, 4 days are over, patient is quite all right, is ambulatory, is tolerating feed, you have done open pyeloplasty, and the drain is draining 500 ml of urine.
I will see, sir, CBC and do an ultrasound abdomen to see if there is any collection, large collection, or there is any rise in the TLC.
Okay, good. So that is one point that you want to see any collection. Okay, ultrasound is normal. No rise in TLC, no fever.
Then I will keep retain the drain, sir, and monitor further, sir.
So how long you will retain?
I will see, sir, if the drain output is coming down, then it probably the leak is resolving. But if the drain output is not coming down and it is increasing, then the chances of that it will heal spontaneously
okay,
are less.
Santosh, what is your plan of action?
Sir, if the drain output, I'll serially monitor the case, sir. If the drain output is slowing down, then I'll keep observation, sir, because usually the mucosal anastomosis will heal within 48 to 72 hours, sir. So okay, usually the leak should subside by that time. But okay, if it is still persisting or increasing, then I will suspect about the leak, sir, in this case.
Okay. Any other point? Pramod, you want to say anything?
So we can check the drain fluid creatinine. We can check whether we can confirm whether it's urine or not.
Second, it's urine. It's confirmed urine.
We do an X-ray KB also to check the position of the stent, whether a DJ stent is in correct position or not.
Okay.
That's one thing.
All right.
It can be from the PCN side. So previously, if it is leaking, then I would like to put PCN, sir, still if it is persisting.
Okay. The patient is already on PCN.
No, PCN is not there. That is point. Okay. So in the persistent drain, there are various reasons. First and foremost, you have to ensure that the catheter is properly in position. Sometimes the catheter can get blocked and then it keeps on refluxing the urine from the DJ stent, and that keeps on coming from the drain. Sometimes if the balloon is excessively overfilled, there is always some amount of residual urine which remains in the bladder, and that causes siphon effect. And that keeps on coming, and therefore there is it keeps on leaking from the anastomosis. The other thing is that balloon is causing a lot of spasms in the bladder, then it causes high pressure, and whatever this urine which is there, residual urine, that keeps on coming into the PC system, and then it keeps on leaking. And the most important thing, when you said I want to see the X-ray for the DJ stent position, most important thing is the position of the drain. Sometimes if you put a drain excessively in and it is very much near the anastomosis, it does not allow the anastomosis to heal. And therefore, when you said that X-ray, that is a correct thing, but that is to see whether drain is excessively in or not. In that case, after 4 or 5 days, you can just withdraw the, if everything is fine, all factors are taken care of, if there is no hydronephrosis, then you just have to withdraw the drain little bit, and that will work together. In case if everything persists, then it is probably because there is some leakage from anastomosis, some part which is not healing. There could be some necrosis of the some area. So in that case, you have to put a nephrostomy. Make sure that nephrostomy keeps on draining properly so that the whole anastomosis remains dry. Urine is completely diverted. And if it is a minor leak, then over a period of time, it will get epithelized and it will the things will heal down. So that is how you have to do the step by step treatment of a persistent urinary leakage. So I think we have covered most of the things related to the POJ. Now, in case if you have any questions, we'll take up those questions. Or if there are any questions which have come up from the audience, we can take up.
And sir, then we can I have a question, sir. Yes. Sir, in this case, can we straight away, instead of going for nephrostomy, we can put a DJ stent as the patient was asymptomatic, no fever, no sepsis was there. So can stent be a
DJ stent, see, your purpose of putting nephrostomy is not relieve the pain and relieve the iatrogenesis, but you want to see whether this kidney is really worth salvaging or not. And therefore, if you put a DJ stent, it is not going to make give you any more idea. So you are back to square one. So in that case, once you put a DJ stent, you necessarily have to go for the isotope rhinogram study again and then decide whether it is whether there is any improvement in the function or not. Whereas nephrostomy will definitely give you all other clues what we discussed in the discussion.
Sir, one more is actually when we are monitoring for the PCN, sir, initially, yeah. We have to compare that osmolarity with urethral, or we can compare with that of the serum also.
No, it is better to compare with the urethral. All the parameters are better to be compared with urethral because that will give you, see, that is a normal kidney which is pouring urine. When you are putting nephrostomy, you assume that all urine is diverted into nephrostomy. And therefore, what is a normal urine and what is the abnormality, you can compare with that. So that is a good idea to compare. Everything, osmolarity, sodium, chloride, bicarbonates, everything.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So thank you very much. I think all of you have done quite well. And you understand that sometimes such case definitely can come in exam, especially the palpable lump. If it is there in the ward, definitely it will be kept. And the questions which examiner will ask are very simple. And you have to just give a very logical answer. Nothing great and nothing high-fi is expected from you. But if you give a very logical and a justifiable answer, then it is definitely accepted to the examiner. What you are doing in your center may be different than what I am doing in my center as an examiner. But if you tell what you are doing, if you tell in a proper justified way, I think all examiners will accept whatever treatment you are telling, whatever evaluation you are doing, whatever investigations you are doing. So don't go with a fixed idea that this examiner likes this, this examiner wants this. Whatever is done in your institute and whichever way you can justify, you have to tell. Okay?
Sir, so there is one question on Facebook post. Just shall I read, sir?
Yeah.
Person, if you do plain CT for anatomy and MAC3 for documenting function, is it right approach initially?
It can be right. See, nobody is going to quarrel with you why you are doing this and why you are doing that. But the logical thing is that when you are doing a CT scan, when you are doing plain CT scan, you just have to inject contrast and then and there you are going to get the whole picture. So why you want to just do plain CT scan, bring it out and then send for another investigations on another day? Here you are going to get the picture and in CT scan, if it shows that it is good, nice concentration and all the pelvic alveolar system is all properly filled up, your diagnosis and everything is made. There is no problem at all.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye. All right, okay.